deep and down on a knee he goes. Florida State and Casey Weldon will operate from their own 20-yard line.
That's the first kick Kaufman has hit into the end zone for a touchback. He'd been really short earlier.
There is Bobby Bowden, and here comes Casey Weldon. Through the first 30 minutes of play, Casey Weldon, 12 of 17, 171 yards, and a pair of touchdown strikes. Detmer, 11 of 21, 162 yards, a fumble, and an interception, both of which led to some of the TDs.
And he's had to work for those 162 yards. A lot of blitzes, a lot of moving around in the pocket so that he could find a receiver downfield. It hasn't been easy for Detmer.
Offense for the Seminoles of Florida State as we get underway here in the third period. Edgar Bennett is grabbed in the backfield. They had him behind the line of scrimmage, and the man who had him was Greg Pitson. Couldn't hold on. He crosses the 21 out near the 22. A gain of a pair. It'll be second down and eight. And good news for Cougar fans, Lenny Gomes, the nose guard who limped out in the last couple of minutes of the first half, is back.
Hey, I talked about it. It's that unbelievable healing power. You just got to walk with the right trainer. He grabs the back of your britches and holds you up about 10 yards. And he was fresh as new. I wish that guy had worked for me when I was playing.
Second down, they're calling it seven. The ball nosing the 23-yard line. Camp Lee out to the 25, and he is smothered there. Gomes is at or near the bottom of that pile.
Florida State will probably try to come back out and somehow get back into that grind-out running game that they had going earlier in the first half. Amp Lee's been on the sidelines for a while. Brigham Young learned a great deal in the first half. And the big factor here in the second half will be how much did they learn and how much will they use from that experience.
Third down in four. Florida State has converted every third down opportunity but one. Oh, in and out of the hands of Matt Fryer. Second pass that Fryer has dropped tonight that he's had right on his belt buckle.
This is just a lack of concentration. Watch as he goes up. He knows he's going to have the first down. As he breaks to the outside, you've got to expect the football to hit him right in the face mask. That's one of those deals. If you're a receiver, you're taught, turn, get your head around, and get your hands up. The ball's going to be there.
Here's Scott Player to kick it away. 210-pound senior. High snap, and Player puts it straight up in the air. Brigham Young guaranteed a great field position. They are marking it out of bounds at the 39-yard line of Florida State.
14-yard punt. Watch how he leans back as he tries to kick this thing. He leans back rather than over the football. It goes off the side of his foot. And that's one of those things that gives Brigham Young a true breather to get going.
You know, Bobby Bowden says punting has been pathetic in the last few years. He says, we're lucky we haven't been killed on special teams. But he reasoned, we don't punt the ball far enough to allow anybody to hurt us. There's an example of that.
They cannot out-kick coverage.
Brigham Young with the football at the FSU 39. Here comes the end around, and Florida State snips it out beautifully. Terrell Buckley. You're not going to fool that veteran corner very often. Eric Hughes on the end around, nothing doing.
The play is botched from the beginning, and it took too long for that receiver to get around there. Buckley was not fooled backside. You want to take advantage on reverses with having an over-pursuing defense. It just didn't work from the beginning. That's one of those things. Deceptive, yes, but you got to be precise in that play.
I'll tell you, with the cost of insurance in Southern California, you got to avoid those collisions at all costs.
It is second down and a load. Detmer going downfield. It is Matsuzaki, and he is overthrown. The Cougar fans, they want a pass interference call.
Great job of doing protection from the offensive line. Matsuzaki, really three men around him. The ball laid in there. That's not a clean play. That's just incomplete. Nothing wrong with that at all. Good news, though, that Matsuzaki's back in the ball game.
Bad news is it's third and 22 for Detmer and company. From the 49-yard line. Count by Detmer. He's got time, steps up, and he
wrapped up and in cover at the Florida State 45-yard line. And the Cougars are going to have to get rid of the football. Keep in mind, Detmer had two separated shoulders. He fell on it that time. He's in a lot of pain. Hit from behind. Maybe it was just his wind. Maybe he's lost his air. As he gets back into the pocket, nobody's there, so he steps up. He wants to throw the ball and dump it off. Eric Hughes was open, but as he comes, there's somebody that comes from behind to hit him. Hand down on the ground. Left shoulder. Left shoulder. He falls on that left shoulder really hard. Ball comes out.
Might have been just the wind knocked out of him. Detmer is up. He's not hanging that left shoulder, but Greg, I thought it was a left shoulder as well. He's got the left arm up, unsnapping the chin strap. I think he's all right. But they're going to kick it away, and on comes Earl Kaufman, and it is Terrell Buckley back at his own 10-yard line. Earlier in this ball game, Buckley returned one for a touchdown, but three clips nullified the return. Fourth down and 15. Good snap. Kaufman will let it go, looking for the near sideline. Buckley with the fair catch at the 13, and he's got it. So a 12-18 to play in the third quarter here at Anaheim. A 32-yard punt. The Seminoles will have the ball when we come back.
3 years ago, we set up...
Paycom Incorporated. It is intended solely for the private use of our audience. Any rebroadcast, retransmission, or other use of this program without the expressed written consent of Raycom Incorporated is prohibited. There's the situation with 12-18 to play here in the third quarter. Florida State led at halftime 28-14, and that is where we stand. Their second possession here in the second half from the I formation. The 20 near the 25, and he has dropped.
Controlled acceleration. Ampley starts to the right side and looking for the daylight. He sees it, then gets up into the hole. Holds on to the football right there. Great job of that.
There is Ampley, and his numbers 11 carries for 51 yards and a touchdown. A first down for the Seminoles of Florida State at their own 24-yard line. Following this ball game, the Seminoles will head home to Dope Campbell Stadium, where 61,000 will undoubtedly be awaiting them on September 7th. Right up the gut it goes, and this time, Brigham Young stops Edgar Bennett Cole. Seminoles will open at home against Tulane, come right back and play Western Michigan. And then on September 28th, it is off to Ann Arbor to take on either number one rank or number two rank Michigan, depending on which poll you subscribe to.
Michigan, a very strong team. There's a good one out here in the West. Pac-10, Washington. Great defense, good ball club. USC, they'll have a chance in the Pac-10. Great running back there if they find a quarterback.
Mazio Royster. Weldon rolling left, throws. He's got a receiver. It is cut by Terrell, and he is jumped on and pushed out of bounds. Josh Arnold, the strong safety, on the tackle after a gain of 14.
As he rolls to the left, Urban Lee, a defensive back for Brigham Young, has to recognize this is the same play that Eric Terrell ran earlier. Once he makes that move and sees the rolling option to the left side, he knows Terrell is here. He gets to that 12-yard mark, stops, puts the brakes on, goes back to the football. Urban Lee was going deep with it.
First down and 10, Florida State. On a drive that began at their own 13-yard line. Here comes Amp Lee again. What a move. He put on number 55, Kevin Nickel, at the line of scrimmage. Rocky Beagle on the tackle. Beagle, 6'1", 225 pounds. In high school in Wisconsin Rapids, Wisconsin, Beagle had 97 wrestling pins, pinned everyone his senior year, and to boot, holds his high school record in the high hurdles at 225 pounds. How is that possible?
Well, he's got to be some of that skill to pin Ampley or Edgar Bennett here in a minute.
Second down and six. Weldon, look at all that time. Throws wide open at the 40-yard line. First down for Florida State once more.
A 21-yard pickup. Now a stop as it's just absolutely frustrate defensive coordinators and players. You've just got to respect so much the running game from Bennett and Lee that when they do the play action pass, guys can get out there and just get open and plenty of time to throw the football. There was no pressure on it that time. Receiver, pitch, and catch.
I'll tell you, Kez McCorvey, he's a redshirt freshman out of Gautier, Mississippi. He's like a top fuel dragster, 0-60 in about 4 seconds. Tremendous acceleration, and we saw it right there. There's the draw. It goes for four more. It is Edgar Bennett once again. Chad Hansen. Brigham Young stopped him.
You saw big Reggie Dixon, number 73, jumping up and down, hitting his head like, hey, follow me or I miss my block one. Offensive linemen, you know, they just don't get that kind of attention, but they're the big sweat hogs up there. They know exactly what's going on. Oftentimes, they know the game of football better than the pretty boys at wide receiver, quarterback, and running back.
McCorvey split wide to the right. The pitch comes to the left side. It is Amp Lee around the corner. To the 11-yard line, and he has tackled there. It'll be a first down for Florida State. Derwin Gray on the stop. And bad news for Amp Lee. Like his knee hit that grass as he was tackled. The toss sweep. Look for the first daylight and get up into it. He sees number 69 leading the way for him. He gets up in there, and it's just a race. He tries to stiff arm. But watch, as Gray is pulling him down, his leg catches, his knee goes back from underneath, and oh! You just hate to see that. His leg will get caught underneath Derwin Gray. You know, that's just, oh. And you know, say this for the grass field. Had that been AstroTurf, there might not have been any give at all. That is terrible. If he's down, this Florida State team is not the same ball club. He is such an integral part of Bobby Bowden's offense, and they are looking at that left shin of Amp Lee, and he is writhing in pain. We will try and find out the extent of that injury as they continue to work on Amp. Of course, he's the 6-foot junior, outstanding tailback.
If there's anything good out of that, is that they were not looking at the knee. They're looking at the shin bone. I believe they call it the fibula. I'm not a doctor, but
the fans reaction.
Oh,
MVP of last year's blockbuster bowl. I'll tell you, Joe Paterno and the Nittany Lions of Penn State, I'm sure they are watching tonight. They remember that man right there and remember him well.
Sean Jackson will be the guy that comes into the ball game to take his place and is an outstanding runner himself.
Not much drop off at all. Good point. He is in the ball game. First man through, Edgar Bennett on the quick hitter down near the five.
Florida State also had the high school player of the year that came there this season. Marquette Smith, a tailback that because of Amp Lee and Sean Jackson has no chance of getting into the ball game. That's total dominance right there in running the ball. They have met their standards. They wanted to run the football, control the clock, and utilize the play action pass. And that has happened.
At the five, there is Sean Jackson as he tries to get around the corner, and there are blue jerseys everywhere as he goes down in a heap of dust. It is Derwin Gray leading the charge. I'll tell you, in his second game of the season last year, Sean Jackson was a freshman. He carried the ball 7 times against Georgia Southern for 112 yards, Greg.
He's a bigger guy. A lot of folks around Florida State say that he reminds them of Sammy Smith, 6'2", 220, a big running back. But you've got to have that field vision. That time there might have been a crease back up inside that he could have run through with that big body. The arm tackle, 7.9 yards a carry.
That is unbelievable. And now, taking over for an injured Amp Lee, it is 3rd and 3 for Florida State. Play action. Well, and looking end zone, he's going to try and run it in, and he's not going to get there. Oh, is he met head on? And leading the charge is Derwin Gray and Tony Crutchfield, but it will be a first down for Florida State.
Well, I don't know. They're marking it over there about a yard short. He probably should have gone ahead and aired the ball out. This is one of those where you've got to be smart and get down. At least he covers the football up, but he doesn't get the first down. And he risks his body. You'd hate to be a Florida State coach. Watch that. your star tailback Cam Lee carried off the field, and then lose Casey Weldon, the mastermind behind it all.
Fourth down and less than a yard. The reason I thought it was a first down is the yard marker had been taken away from the sideline because the play went that way. Watch for number 22, Edgar Bennett. He's got it, and he's got the touchdown.
Sheer power, offensive linemen score with your man. They push them into the end zone. You know that your ball carrier scores. Shad Hansen, number 50's middle linebacker there. He's getting pounded in this goal line offense. Third touchdown tonight. He's had one by reception, two by running.
Player down in the end zone. It is a Florida State player.
Look at that dust blowing up. His knee. They'll try to cool it down there.
He's a sophomore out of Jacksonville, Florida, a backup tight end to both Warren Hart and Lonnie Johnson.
Top right of your screen, you'll see him here come into it. He gets hit by somebody coming across. His leg gets stuck in that dirt briefly, but once again, at least it's dirt and it gives. That can of air or white stuff that he was spraying on there is extremely cold. It's like it's a freezing thing that, as well as a player, you hate to feel it, but you know it's making you numb, so go ahead, Doc, give it to me.
Now the walking wounded from Farrell to Amp Lee. As you look at the bandage around that left shin, and Craig, I think you called it absolutely correctly, not a knee nor an ankle, and that is certainly good news for that man right there.
It's also good news that he's putting weight on that leg. I'm not so sure that a lot of doctors would recommend that until they get some x-rays of it. I would think they'd want him to stay off of it in case it is broken.
Now thus far in the ball game, what a night he's had. Amp Lee, 13 carries for 75 yards and one touchdown.
He's going to have a partner pretty soon on the x-ray table. Marvin Farrell will be right along beside him. Let's only hope that Farrell has as good a fortunate or at least early diagnosis as Amp Lee.
Following the touchdown, on to attempt the point after. Here is Dan Mowry once more. From the hold of Brad Johnson. And he has got it. With 7:10 remaining in the third period, Florida State now out in front of BYU 35-14. Back after these men have some room to gallop. Florida State, 86 yards, 11 plays, 5-0-8. And the most important thing about the Florida State drive, other than the fact, Craig, that they're scoring, is they are chewing big chunks off that scoreboard clock.
And converting third downs and fourth downs now.
Cougars have the ball, first down at their own 24-yard line. Brigham Young. Boy, Buckley has had a punt return for a touchdown called back, and now to Bobby Bowden's dismay.
That will be a 15-yard penalty and first down.
The interception will not go. It would have been Buckley's second tonight.
Buckley went through the wide receiver. Watch as he goes just right through Hughes. Hughes knows that he's been hit. Two of them tonight, but you've got to be cautious in going after that football. Yes, you have a right to it as a defensive back, but you cannot go through the wide receiver.
You know, Eric Hughes turned back a track scholarship at Brigham Young to go after a football career. He has not played football since high school. Well, look at those penalties against Florida State. They're eight. And Bowden is, I would say, a little unnerved. First down, Cougars at their own 40. Bootleg left side, Detmer with time. Now turns back to the right, and down he'll go. Troy Sanders, tremendous pursuit on that right side. We pause briefly for station identification. This is the Raycom Network.
This is WCTV, Channel 6, Thomasville, Tallahassee.
With Craig James, I'm Phil Stone. We have 6:24 to play here in the third quarter from Anaheim Stadium. And this is the second Disneyland Pigskin Classic. Second down and 18 for Brigham Young. Detmer again, the seven-step drop, underthrows the coverage. It is caught. Charlton out of the backfield on his feet, out near the 39. And Brigham Young still faced with third and a bundle. Greg, you said at the outset of our telecast we would see Detmer do more sprinting out than we have seen tonight.
And they've tried to mix it up just a little bit, but right at this point here, they realize Florida State is not going to pressurize them so much with a blitz, so they can get back into the pocket and allow Detmer to use his downfield reads and keys.
Bryce Doman has just come back into the ball game. Doman, a 6'1 sophomore out of Salt Lake City. He comes to the near side. On third and 11, Doman is in motion. Detmer looking right to the short side of the field. Eludes one would-be tackler, coming to the near side. Detmer unloads and throws it away. He had Doman wide open at the 47-yard line, looked at him, knew Doman didn't have the first down yardage, and tried to get to a receiver who was past the first down marker.
And once the quarterback begins to scramble, wide receivers need to come back to him, get in his line of vision so that he can throw the ball to him. It looked like they all kind of mumbled jumbled together and wanted to try to go deep up the sideline that Florida State's sitting over here. They can't outrun anybody. Deep, come back, get open.
Kaufman to kick it away. No pressure whatsoever. Here is Buckley. He'd love to break one that would count. Buckley loses his balance. Two Cougars in him, three Cougars, four Cougars, and the first one slams him down. Boy, a flying souffle. And whoa, what a tackle it was. 44-yard punt, minus 7 yards on the return, and Brad Clark with the takedown.
In trying to...
Now Florida State is out in front of the Cougars 35-14 with 5:03 to play. And you can bet on the near sideline, the buzz amongst the punt return unit for Florida State is that takedown of Terrell Buckley by Brad Clark.
Rocky Beagle's not the only guy that knows how to wrestle this ball club. There's Lee on the crutches. Farrell, the guy that had his leg hurt on the scoring play by Edgar Bennett.
It is first down and 10 from the 12-yard line. Florida State, Brigham Young showing blitz. And they're coming. Edgar Bennett simply ran by everybody who was on the way to the Florida State backfield. Lenny Gomes there at the bottom of that pile. Now you look at the first half, Florida State, 311. Thus far in the second half, they have 96, but the story is where has the Cougar offense been?
Not many times you'll ever see negative yardage in a half by Brigham Young University. Talking about all those 300-yard games that Detmer's thrown for. Just outmanned tonight. There's more talent on Florida State's bench, probably in the second team.
That's a good point. I said at the outset, they are two and three deep at virtually every position. Weldon on the run, moves the pocket out to the right side. It is caught by Sean Jackson. A gain of 14, and we talk about depth. Ampley, the starting tailback, little drop off at all when you put Sean Jackson in that ball game.
Nice play action to Edgar Bennett. He's had such a good night that drew everybody in. Sean Jackson out in the flat, linebacker behind him. He's got to realize that and also know that he's got Jackson in the flat. 6'2", 220, and can run. Just a storyline for Florida State. 2 and 3 deep throughout this ball club.
Right side, short side, of the field. Again, it is Sean Jackson. He is stacked up by Greg Pitts and Jared Levitt of Brigham Young. Go back to 1990 when Sean Jackson in high school, first All-American to commit to Florida State in 1990, I should say, rated the top athlete among the nation's prep prospects back in 1989.
Bobby Bowden said 1990 was a rebuilding year for them. 10-2. How many head coaches do you know that would like to be 10-2 and rebuild every year?
They don't rebuild at Florida State, Miami, or Florida. They simply reload. Well, looks to the right side, comes back to the near side. Pass intended for Kez McCorvey. I'll tell you, McCorvey spent a year watching All-American Lawrence Dawsey, who is now with the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. And I'll tell you, that can only help that young man out of Gautier, Mississippi.
Talk about controlling the clock. How about the total plays that have taken place in this ballgame? Florida State 61-38 for BYU. You can't score if you don't have possession of the football.
Matt Pryor into the ballgame, replacing McCorvey. It is third down now and six. In motion, Terrell. Looks right and comes left. It is caught at the 45-yard line. McCorvey on the receiving end, and a first down for Florida State.
The old helmet in the nostril trick. As he gets older, he'll realize when your journey is completed, when it's over with, get down on the grass, save the body.
There's a look at the offensive line from Brigham Young. It is a very young group, only one starter back. That is Brian May from last year's team. And Lavelle Edwards told me yesterday, Craig, that he thinks by the third or fourth game of this 1991 season, that group is going to be a very, very good group of down linemen.
He feels there's more talent on this team than last year's ball club. They just don't have the experience.
Jackson. Flag goes down. Randy Brock tried to arm tackle Sean Jackson on the way by and got nothing. And there is a very, very unhappy Ty Detmer. He lost his leading receiver, Micah Matsuzaki. Right there he is. In the second quarter, he had caught, I believe, four passes for 72, 73 yards. I'll tell you, when you lose...
On the offense, during the run, repeat first down.
Craig, you lose your leading receiver in the ballgame, Micah Matsuzaki. You come into this 1991 season, Lavelle Edwards having lost his four top receivers to graduation. That doesn't leave a whole lot of people for your Heisman Trophy winner to throw to.
And a young, inexperienced offensive line, nobody to protect that Detmer. There's so many question marks on this team right now. It'll just take time before they can all come together, like you're talking about, 3 or 4 weeks into the schedule, but they've got such a brutal start that it's going to be really hard on them for those first two or three games.
They're at UCLA and at Penn State. Weldon looking right side. He has got Baker. Out across the 40-yard line, and he is spun down at the 41. Clock continues to run with 2:13 to play in the third period. We're pleased to welcome our viewers tuning in on Prime Network and their nationwide family of regional sports cable networks all across this fine country of ours. Wherever you are, we certainly hope you are enjoying football here in Southern California. Florida State, preseason number one in most of the major polls, and the ones they are not number one in, they are number two behind the Wolverines of Michigan. Second down now and 13 from the 42-yard line. Weldon looking left. It is caught out of the backfield. Who else? Edgar Bennett. Scott Giles on the stop. Giles, the senior outside linebacker out of Provost, Utah. I'll tell you what. They are fanatical about football in the state of Florida. Greg, you know that.
I saw a rental car today. Somebody must have flown in from Florida, and they had these Seminole signs all over the car. That rental car may never be the same again.
I'll tell you, football is Florida, Florida State, and Miami. Oof, it is a way of life. That is Shannon Baker in motion to the near side. Weldon looking at him. Now scrambles left. Wants to go downfield. Will come to the near sideline. It is Bennett. He's got it. And out of bounds.
Browns at the 28-yard line.
Well, then now 19 of 26 for 260 yards, and the flag is down. It will go against, I believe, Florida State.
Well, it went beyond the line of scrimmage when he let the football go. Casey could have just run the football here. Play action, once again, draws in the Brigham Young defense. He knows he could have gotten the first down by running right here, but he's kind of waves the receiver down. He wants Bennett to go deeper, and he can let the fullback run with the football. Outstanding catch. Edgar Bennett is an all-around great player.
We have an
player.
Illegal forward pass. That's a 5-yard penalty, and it's a loss of down. We'll be fourth down.
That might be the only thing that stops Florida State. They've converted on most third downs throughout the evening. Casey looking up at the in-house monitor in the end zone saying, hey, I didn't go past the line of scrimmage.
10th penalty against Florida State for 94 yards. Fortunately, if you are a Seminole fan, the penalties, six of them major, have not hurt them. Player lets it go. It is Takahima who will take it out of bounds. 42-yard punt, a 2-yard return, and with 42 seconds to play in the third period, we will step away. On comes Detmer.
To get rid of
their way through their opponent. On Wednesday night in pennant-feverish Atlanta, the Braves blanked the Mets 2-0 behind John Smoltz and reliever Mike Stanton. Dave Justice and Rafael Belliard drove home the runs. Ronnie Gant with some aggressive base running to make it home. Atlanta's won four straight, and its 32-16 record's the best in baseball since the break. Atlanta leads L.A. by a game and a half, pending the outcome of the Pirates-Dodgers in L.A. The Dodgers' 9.5 game lead over Atlanta at the All-Star break has completely evaporated. L.A. is trying to remain a game back, but it's East leading Pittsburgh on top thanks to a two-run single by Orlando Merced. Ranked teams got together. Number one Florida State against 19th-ranked BYU and Heisman winner Ty Detmer. This one's been all Seminoles. They lead it handily in the third. Nighttime U.S. Open action, a lot easier.
Teams are like, but this one here looked like they were on top of us. My hair ran up my back. They were so close.
I could see the rivets on the underside of the wings. That's how close they were. First and 10, Brigham Young. Eric Grage. He has got the ball out across the 23 near the 24. It's the third year in the program for Grage. He is just a sophomore.
Grage goes up the field, looks and sees the zone. Good job of stepping into that little hole right there, and then he should have gotten straight up the field to get the first down. You're not going to get half foot speed to outrun anybody in the Florida State secondary, east and west.
Second down, a little more than one. Tui Peloto, he has a pair of touchdowns tonight. He will be short of the first down. And that will be the final play of this third period. Now, don't go away. We'll be back with more after these messages from your local station. The Seminoles dominant in virtually every offensive category.
Brigham Young should have taken advantage of Florida State field possession that time. They started three drives, the 20, their own 14, and their own 11, yet they came away with absolutely no points in that quarter.
Well, Casey Weldon, he has every right to be happy with what he has done tonight. Pass interference, second one tonight. Yes, indeed, and it will go against Errol McCorvey. I'll tell you one thing that these two flags against Florida State secondary show me. They have tremendous speed getting to the football, and they don't care who's there. They're going to get to it.
This is a sign of a young receiver, inexperienced. He starts drifting down the field.
Automatic first down, spot a foul.
Charlton's got to realize once you go out there as a receiver, you've got to come back to the football. You do not drift down the field and towards McCorvey and your defensive backs. He's lucky that ball wasn't picked off, and he's also lucky that they got the pass interference. 100 yards in penalties for Florida State, yet they're still blowing them out 35-14.
First down and 10, Cougars. Detmer underthrows the coverage. Oh, my! Good evening, Eric Mortensen. First time tonight he has touched the football, and Derek Brooks is all over him.
identical thing that Charlton did. He kind of just fades back into the coverage. Look at him kind of gaining yards. Those two or three extra yards cost him a big hit and a reception. Holding on the inside there, we couldn't pick that up. But had he stayed in place just in this side of that line of scrimmage, then he would have made that reception, and it would have at least got them 3, 4, 5 yards.
And there is the man who put the hit on him, Derek Brooks.
I'll say he is a third-string player. That's the kind of depth the Seminoles have.
We were teasing some of the Florida State guys. They need to figure out a loaner program.
Penalized half the distance to the goal. Repeat first down.
You'll see the holding. Brian May, left side of your screen there. 72, holding on to those shoulder pads. If you're going to hold, you better get up underneath where they tie the shoulder pads, inside, behind the numbers. Man, those officials are good. They can spot anything out there.
Brigham Young, only their second first down of the second half in both of them. It is now first and 25 for the Cougars. And Detmer wants to pull the trigger again as he looks downfield. It is in and out of the hands of a Seminole three. Dive for it. None can come up with it. The man with the best shot was Derek Brooks. There's what you call throwing into coverage.
Detmer's not too happy here. He thought he should have gotten interference, but he's also very lucky that he didn't have an interception. He forced that throw. He's in the pocket, 7 steps back. If there are three guys around the ball that time, then you have to find somebody that's got single coverage or that maybe is in a flat zone hookup. 13 of 26, 178 yards, one interception for last year's Heisman Trophy winner.
It is now second and 24. Detmer from behind, no. Across the 21-yard line, dives after the 24.
Detmer showing a little shake and bake. I tell you what, it's amazing what fear will do. Eyes in the back of the helmet. Nose, he's being chased from behind. Watch the wiggle. Oh, yes. Oh, McCormick, you went the wrong way. He didn't think Detmer had that in him.
Incidentally, Detmer's favorite target in the first half, Micah Matsuzaki, out of the game with a hamstring. Third down and 15. Detmer looks to the short side of the field with time. Completes it to the 29. But it's no good whatsoever. Ken Alexander on the stop, and Brigham Young is going to have to boot the football away once more. Two things at play for Brigham Young. One, Detmer simply does not have anyone to throw to in 1991. Two, Florida State's defensive secondary and linebacking core have been awesome tonight. 10 men on the line. Seminoles looking like they're going to send everybody. It is Buckley back at his own 32. Earl Kaufman, top punter in the Western Athletic Conference a year ago, has punted well tonight. And there is an example of what he has done all evening long. Buckley, fair catch at the 24. A 47-yard punt for Kaufman. When we return, 13:03 remaining. Florida State will have the ball. It has simply lit it up offensively. And just about a mile from here, talking about lighting it up, the Electrical Light Parade is underway at Disneyland. And oh, what a spectacle that is. Second annual Disneyland Pigskin Classic. Roger Rabbit is here. You've seen Goofy, Mickey, and Minnie are in attendance tonight.
Turn a little Seminole on there, huh?
Seminole fans, no matter where you go across America, they are there in droves. And Florida State, number one in the nation, out in front of Brigham Young, 35-14. Weldon still wants to throw the football, and he has got Sean Jackson for the second time tonight. In case you have just joined us and are wondering, where is Amp Lee? Well, he is somewhere under an X-ray machine. He went out with a bruised shin in the third period after a tackle. And they are x-raying his knee just to make certain there is no knee damage. Thus far tonight, Casey Welch playing the role of Ty Detmer.
And he showed it right there, how he bought himself enough time, realized he had Sean Jackson in the flat, and then completed it. At this rate here, he'll have his career high for a single game. Boy, this is over with.
Baker is wide to the left. The pitch will go to the left side. Jackson once more. He'll turn it up inside, following Mancini and Patrick McNeil. Now there is what is happening over at Disneyland right now. That is live from the Magic Kingdom. Boy, Craig, that is just one of the most beautiful parades I have ever seen.
They do such a great job of entertaining people. If you travel from around the world to come here and see Disneyland, you get your money's worth. I mean, it's phenomenal, all of the sights and things that they can do for you. I mean, they make a living at entertaining, and they know how to do it.
You want a little tip? When the electrical parade is going on at Disneyland, that's the time to hit the e-coupon attractions. Nobody's in line. Third down and two now from the 31-yard line. Florida State on the move. Brigham Young trying valiantly to shut him down. Well, bootleg right side. He can run for it. To the 44-yard line. A gain of 13. Tony Crutchfield finally brings him down.
Number 55, left side of your screen, Kevin Nicolai. It's his job to stay back there. He gets pulled. He tries to go in and make the tackle on the play action. Casey Weldon just has all the running room in the world. The misdirection of the backs is something that linebackers need to learn how to read. They need to recognize what's going on. That was a good fake, but they've got to see that, particularly your backside linebacker that's responsible for the naked boot coming back with the quarterback.
The offensive line of Brigham Young. While they have protected Detmer fairly well tonight, Ty has simply not had anybody to throw to. Very, very thin in 1991 for Cougar receivers. Not much there. And Ty admitted that yesterday. Well, throwing for the far side, and he's caught at the 45-yard line. Baker, the 5'10 junior flanker out of Lakeland, Florida, is smothered immediately by Irwin Lee.
Casey Weldon, what a strong arm. I was looking forward to seeing how well he performed. Steps up in the pocket, lets it go out there. Shannon Baker, low into the outside. No chance at all for Lee to make a play on that pass.
You know, Shannon Baker is probably about his most experienced wide receiver. 21 catches a year ago for 4 touchdowns. What speed? Listen to this. In a split in a 4x100-meter relay, his split 9.4. Well, ooh, look at that pass. He simply drilled it into the chest of tight end Warren Hart. Reggie Johnson is gone, now a Denver Bronco, and Bobby Bowden expecting big things from his sophomore tight end Warren Hart out of Jacksonville, Florida. There are Weldon's numbers, 21 of 28, 269 yards. Interestingly enough, Weldon is a senior. He has only one 300-yard game. It came last year against the Gators of Florida. Boy, he had 3 completions in that game of 50 yards or more. Sean Jackson, look at him break it. Said they have it. Jackson says no, but I believe Brigham Young pulled it away. Hold everything.
Sean Jackson averaged 7.9 yards a carry last year. This will pick it up where they're at right now. Great job of just having determination, never allowing one man to bring you down as a ball carrier. There's the fumble. Who comes up with it? They give it to Florida State.
Following a 36-yard run, the Seminoles will hold on to the football. It is first and goal at the Brigham Young 3. Sean Jackson, since coming on for Amp Lee, 5 carries for 56 yards. He's got it again. Touchdown, Florida State.
complete. There's good job right there on the offensive line of not allowing penetration. And then Jackson, what, he knows he's got a big body. 6'2", 220. Just go ahead and get it up in there, north and south. You've got momentum. They're not coming at you. You're going at them. They're on their heels. Use your big body.
And here is Mowry. The point after, he drills it. And with 10:08 to play in this ball game, Florida State now beginning to pour it on. Back with more in a moment.
Possessions took the wind out of Brigham Young. They scored touchdowns. Edgar Bennett, two running touchdowns, one through the air. Brigham Young, three total yards in the third quarter. We're talking about one of the most explosive offenses in all of 1980. And they can only come up with three total yards. Florida State wanted to run the football, and they've done that tonight. 261 yards. Brigham Young only 39.
And Mowry will let it go. End over end. It is taken by Brad Clark at the 6-yard line. Flags go down. It'll be clipping, and Clark is going down at the 21-yard line. Thus far in the ball game, the Seminoles of Florida State, 529 total yards. I'll tell you, those are the kind of numbers that Cougar fans are accustomed to amassing.
The clip here, really, you know, it's one of those things to where if you're a blocker on a kickoff return team.
Flipping during the run back.
You get your head on the numbers side of the man, of the guy covering the kickoff. You know, don't leave any question to where the referee can throw the flag on you.
Second time here in the second half that the Cougars will begin from inside their own 10-yard line. Otai Detmer, it has been an evening of frustration, and you wonder if perhaps this might be a microcosm of the 1991 season for the senior Heisman Trophy winner of 1990. Detmer, play action from his own end zone. He'll step up. He's going down, and we have got a safety. Defensive lineman for Florida State. And again, we talk about depth.
The play action fake, but it does absolutely no good there. Footman and the rest of them come in and just bring him down. And there's nobody open in the secondary for him to throw to right now. I mean, it's just...
Clock stop, 9:55 to play. When we come back, the Seminoles are going to have it going again. Safety, and that is really been, in microcosm form, the story of this ball game. It has been all Florida State. Everything they have attempted to do offensively and defensively has worked. Terrell Buckley at the 31, and oh, can he break it? Cut from behind, loses the football, and is still free, and I believe the Cougars have it. They do. Brigham Young has the football at the Florida State 32.
I believe Herget was the guy that was called for clipping a while ago. His own man gets in his way. The ball comes out before it hits the ground. So that is a legitimate fumble. Herget is there to make the recovery. This is the kind of break that Brigham Young needed in the first or second quarter. Right now, it's a little bit late. They're long ways before they can catch up. But at this point in the ball game, Brigham Young is trying to build for the future. Weeks 2, 3, and 4. They need to find some kind of momentum.
They've got UCLA next week and Penn State in 2 weeks. Both on the road. Draw play, and oh my, Charlton tackled behind the line of scrimmage, springs free, and picks up 3 yards. They had him 3 yards deep and couldn't hold him.
Tupelotu, he's the guy that's, you know, out there by example, leading with his skills. Some of the younger players on this ball club, the inexperienced guys, have seen how he's rushed the football with his two running touchdowns. That effort right there, that's the kind of things that he needs to, you know, to exemplify to his teammates.
It is now second down and 8. The ball at the 31-yard line. Zephyr swings out to Tui Palulu. He is still on his feet. Sheds two tacklers at the 30 and dives to the 24. Marvin Jones on the stop. Now, Brigham Young, I mentioned a moment ago, they travel to the Rose Bowl next Saturday to take on UCLA, and then it's off to Penn State. And then they come home on the 28th Air Force, which beat Ohio State at the Liberty Bowl. They also travel to Colorado State. We watched them, Craig, at the Freedom Bowl right here a year ago, beat Oregon. And then it is San Diego State on the road, and that will not be an easy game with All-American Patrick Rowe at one wide receiver for the Aztecs. For Brigham Young, it is the toughest schedule they have ever had. It's Tula Mealy. He is a high school freshman out of Hawaii. Tremendous recruit. Well, Bill Edwards told me Mealy is one of the most gifted athletes he has ever had at BYU.
And a guy that's probably going to be a starter maybe next week. Byron Rex, a good player, had three receptions early in the first quarter. But Mealy is one that they really feel can give them an added dimension at tight end slash wide receiver type of skill.
Fourth down and two. The ball at the 25-yard line. Florida State with five down linemen. Here they come. Detmer sees them, steps up. We've got a flag. It will go against Brigham Young. When you talk Brigham Young, you realize 19 BYU players hold 92 NCAA records. Most of them are quarterback records. Golden Richards.
Dead ball.
Punt returns.
Procedure. Offense. Repeat fourth down.
Boy, you talk about the legacy of great quarterbacks at Brigham Young. Just take a look. Virgil Carter, Gifford Nielsen, Mark Wilson, McMahon, Young, then Robbie Bosco, who led the Cougars to a national championship, the last team to go undefeated 13-0 in 84, and now Ty Detmer with 42 NCAA records and counting. Detmer to pull the trigger on fourth and seven. He's going for it, counter receiver. Touchdown, Brigham Young. It is Eric Grage.
Looks like there was blown coverage in the Florida State secondary. He released Grage, thinking that the free safety Fowler was going to be over there to take him. Buckley just didn't know who was behind him. You know, you get a little lackadaisical in the secondary when you're up 44-14, and that's what happens to you.
Well, certainly another element there. Brigham Young has not shown the deep threat throughout the game, so perhaps the Florida State secondary had no reason to drop deep. But that is something I'm certain the Brigham Young offensive brain trust is going to want to look at more and more early on in this 91 season. Coffin, he tacks on the point after. That'll stop the clock with 7:22 remaining. And it is Florida State 44, now Brigham Young with 21. Don't go away. More of the second annual Disneyland.
The Braves are currently 1.5 up on the Dodgers, who are dueling with East leading Pittsburgh.
Making it. Now, Roman Anderson, the All-American kicker for the University of Houston, has a pretty interesting tactic that he's trying right now. He's working on kicking extra points from the sideline, giving himself only 6 feet of room, a mental thing. And he's hitting those things so that when he goes out, that 18 feet 6 inches looks like there's a lot of room.
That's not a bad philosophy. The NCAA rule change, width of the uprights, as you said, going from 23 feet 4 inches. From the 4-yard line, Tiger McMillan. Oh, can he motor as he stretches the ball out across the 36? A 32-yard return by Tiger McMillan. He is a redshirt freshman out of Kissimmee, Florida. That style of running reminds me a lot of another former Florida State star, Dexter Carter. Elusive, kind of uncanny balance.
New quarterback coming into the ball game.
It is Brad Johnson. He is the man who started the 1990 season for Florida State. He is a senior out of Black Mountain, North Carolina, up near Asheville. Near side.
Everybody talks about Florida State's tough schedule. Well, here it is. They're at Michigan September the 28th. They've got a couple of weeks to prepare for that ball game. Syracuse, Virginia Tech, Middle Tennessee State, not exactly tough ball clubs for them, but they don't need that because they're at LSU, a young team last year that will be improved. Louisville, those guys, Snellenberger said, it's more talented of a team that he has there. Miami and Florida to finish the season off. A lot of eyes in that month on those two ball games. Second down and three. Across the 45, near the 46, goes Marquette Smith. Last ball, he was carrying a football for Lake Howell High School in Castleberry, Florida. Boy, a year ago, Craig, he was USA Today's most valuable offensive high school player in the nation. One of the most celebrated players in Florida State high school history. And I'll tell you what, there have been an incredible number of outstanding athletes to come out of the state of Florida. Tell you what, they play high school football like some Division I schools play in college. Third down now and two. That is William Floyd, a redshirt freshman who was the number three fullback on the depth chart behind both Edgar Bennett and Paul Moore. 6 minutes and 21 seconds to play. As the clock stops while they move the first down marker.
Florida State came for anything that Brigham Young brings. They were expecting, because of some comments by the linebackers that Brigham Young made in the local papers, to see some variations.
Paul Moore, number 32, senior out of Killian High School in Miami, on the carry as he crosses the midfield stripe. And we talked about rule changes. Here's a biggie, Craig. Players are no longer permitted to write words or numbers on their body, wristbands, or adhesive tape. And I'm certain that will send a shockwave through the enclaves of collegiate football. No more graffiti on the arms or wrists.
There'll be a lot of players discouraged because they can't send notes to the girlfriend.
Second down now in 5:23 to play. Pitch comes near side. Football is loose. And who's got it? Florida State recovers it. And it is Tiger McMillan. We have had fireworks tonight on the part of Florida State in Disneyland with their own version. Well, I'll tell you, the last couple of days here in Anaheim, the Disneyland Pigskin Classic, the Orange County Sports Association, do they know how to throw a party?
Very, very well prepared, well organized, on time.
For the near side, it is Marquette Smith.
There's the sign of a young back coming into college football that last year when he was in high school football was able to dip inside and then outrun everybody around the corner. And, you know, he's trying to do that here tonight. And even though Brigham Young's not an overly fast team, not even really even considered a speedy defense, they're still more prepared and better than the high school ball clubs that he faced in his senior year.
Minutes and 8 seconds to play as the clock continues to run here in Anaheim on fourth down and 10. It is a high snap. Scott Player is after it. So are Cougar players, and Player is going to go down at the 4-yard line. Derwin Gray shot through there, and he went nonstop, the express train to Scott Player. Now, Bobby Bowden talked yesterday about the poor punting game. It's historical in Seminole country.
One of the weaknesses on this ball club and the question marks was the special teams and the tight end play. These are kind of some of the things you really can't measure in preseason when you're working at two-a-days in camp. And right now, they get to go out and evaluate their deep snappers, their punters, their field goal extra point kicker. And they'll be able to go back now on the films when they get back to Tallahassee and say, hey, we got to get better at snapping the football. You can't do that. Phil, I've been involved with a game one time, unfortunately, where we were ahead of Brigham Young by 20 points with 2 minutes and 33 seconds to go in the ball game, and they came back and beat us 46-45. Jim McMahon at the helm, and he wasn't even a Heisman Trophy winner. I mean, that's just the kind of mystique that Brigham Young has.
You talk about Brigham Young. A year ago, Ty Detmer won the Heisman. Deservedly so. Question is, as he
completes his last crusade at Brigham Young, his senior season. What about his NFL potential?
Everybody knows David Klingler will be a number one pick in the draft that will be coming up. He's the prototype. You look at the size of Klingler and Detmer. Grade him out at a five because he's really not that big. We've seen three pass deflections.
Here is the Heisman Trophy winner as he tries to engineer Brigham Young's fourth touchdown drive of the night. They have three already, and they're not going anywhere there. Clock continues to run, 346, 345. It is Florida State 44, the Cougars of Brigham Young 21. Two tremendous programs showcased here in this second Disneyland Pigskin Classic. Bobby Bowden, Seminoles of Florida State. And for Lavelle Edwards, six times Western Athletic Coach of the Year. It has been a tough, tough ball game. Brigham Young, a pair of wide receivers, split wide right. In motion, it is Drage. Detmer, straight back, throws. It is caught out of the backfield, Eric Mortensen. And he is taken out at about the six-yard line by Terrell Buckley.
That's one of the toughest catches any receiver can make on the playing field. You're running away from the quarterback, full speed. The ball comes over your shoulder. You've got to concentrate. It's out in front of your body, and it's all hands. You cannot use your body there. Outstanding job by Eric Mortensen of watching that ball in.
Ty Detmer, 223 passing yards tonight. He is on the verge of having his 24 games 300 plus yardage through the airwaves eclipsed. Detmer throws it up for grabs. Touchdown! Oh my, Eric Hughes. A split end junior out of Mesquite, Nevada. I didn't think that ball.
Detmer, by just enough time, throws the football up to get it over those pass rushers so that he can get it into the end zone. And Eric Hughes, an outstanding job also of knowing where his receivers are. He's got a lot of pressure coming at him. The ball goes up. We talked about his size. He made up for it there, or lack of size.
And he sends it whistling through the uprights. So with 2:27 to play, Florida State's margin has now been reduced, but just a little. Seminoles within 20 yards of the football, and they're going to try and drop it into the open spaces. The ball is free, and the Seminoles pounce on it. Florida State will have the football.
Nice attempt. That's a good job. You want to pooch the ball over those front 10 men on the hands team and then hope that you've got speed to get down there and cover it. They get the bounce that they were looking for. And it just, if he gets by number 17, then there you've got to bring a young guy that comes in there and can jump on it potentially. Nice job of trying to get the play executed. It just, it's a gamble. You hope that it works for you, but it doesn't always bounce your way.
First and 10, Florida State. Matt Johnson with the handoff to Edgar Bennett. Well, next week, the Cougars will take on UCLA and quarterback Tommy Maddox at the Rose Bowl in Pasadena. And then after a week off, it is off to University Park to meet the Nittany Lions of Penn State. Boy, it is the toughest schedule in BYU history. Well, tonight it is no secret whatsoever. If you have been with us since the opening kickoff, right there is your Disneyland Pigskin Classic player of the game. And look at those numbers. He is deserving.
A field general that just leaped to the forefront right now at this part of the college season in the Heisman Trophy balloting.
I'll tell you, when he wasn't unloading those 28 aerials, he was getting the ball into the gut of both Amp Lee and Edgar Bennett.
Showed real good decision-making skills tonight. I mean, he has a strong arm. He went to the right receivers. I was very impressed with his performance.
Now FSU interconference wins. There's Johnson, bootleg around the right side. He turns it upfield, still on his feet, and is stopped at the 49-yard line, and that will stop the clock. Dave Henderson covers him, the senior strong safety out of Longview, Texas, as he cuts his legs out from under him.
Once you get the football, you've got to convert. You've got to convert on first downs. Look here in the second half alone. 15 Florida State, and both of those from Brigham Young coming on penalties.
And they had the over-the-head punt, the snap that was poor that they fielded at the 10-yard line. That was the turn of possession there, resulted in the touchdown just a moment ago.
Now Florida State, loaded with depth, experience, speed, talent. They are poised to rock the college football world here in 1991. 1988, they were preseason number one. Miami drubbed them in the season opener in 1989. Back-to-back losses opened the season. Then they won 10 in a row. Last year, October losses, I believe, to Miami and Auburn, and then a closing flurry of six straight victories.
Eric Terrell just got kicked out of the ball game.
Our executive producer
from this booth, people sending us information and all of the shots that come from the cameras around the stadium. And, you know, they kind of make us look good up here, but all the work's going on around the stadium from these people that you're seeing right now.
Just tremendous help all the time. Sean Jackson around the left side. Oh, what a move. A 360, and he has on his feet to the 34. That one will make the Seminole highlight reel here in 91.
There'll be a lot of highlights from different players throughout this season.
Well, Baker backs up Eric Terrell at the flanker spot. McCorvey behind Fryer. It's split in. Oh, what depth, what talent. And there is Bennett. He's got three touchdowns tonight, and he is rambling for more at the 27-yard line of Brigham Young. We are inside a minute with 41 seconds to play.
You gotta wonder why Edgar Bennett's still in the ballgame. They've already lost to Amp Lee. Bobby Bowden, he was kind of funny yesterday when he was talking about his team and saying how that, you know, hey, we got so many players on this ball club. Somebody asked him about winning a national championship, and he gave the referral to how Colorado lost last year early. He says, hey, I don't care. I hope we lose tomorrow night. Then we'll win the national championship.
Well, he is the Dean of Sunshine State Coaches. Bowden has coached against nine different head coaches at arch rival Florida and Miami. Bobby Bowden in his 16th year at Florida State as we tick it down. That's it. The second annual Disneyland Pigskin Classic is in the record book. Top-ranked Florida State. They flexed early. They flexed often as they demolish the Cougars of Brigham Young 44-28. What great head coaches, Lavelle Edwards of Brigham Young, a gentleman all the way, and Bobby Bowden of Florida State. Back to wrap it up for you.
Maybe the whole country's saying it. Yeah, they're impressed about everybody. Bobby Bowden had said the time for talk was over. Let's play. And with that, Florida State put on the running shoes for what they hope will be a trek toward a national title. Quickly, it became clear. Bobby Bowden had his team primed for a run at the title. Now, the defense stuffed BYU. And then on Florida State's first possession, first play from scrimmage, in fact, into the bag of tricks, the reverse to Shannon Baker, out to the 28, good for 14 yards. BYU's Lavelle Edwards starting to get that empty feeling. 86-yard drive capped by a Casey Weldon to Edgar Bennett touchdown combination. The Tribe in front, 7-0. When BYU got the ball back, it was Mr. Detmer's turn to meet the Florida State defense. No one open. Freeman putting on the heat. He'll strip the ball, fumble. Simpson recovered, and the Noles were back in business inside BYU territory. The call to Bennett, and Edgar had his second touchdown of the evening. The extra point off the mark, 13-0 FSU. But Bowden all business. Sure enough, the Cougars answered. Tui Palutu into the end zone. BYU had caught a breath of life, 13-7 Florida State. But that was enough to wake up the Noles. Weldon to Terrell, out of Godby. Touchdown. FSU went for two. They got it. Now it was 21-7 with more to come. About 5 minutes to go before the intermission. Another Florida State drive capped by Amp Lee. Scamper Tribe moving almost at will, 28-7. But BYU got off the canvas. Tui Palutu, up the gut, 22-yard touchdown run. His second touchdown of the night. FSU led 28-14. Bad news, Amp Lee out with a leg injury, but Edgar Bennett kept banging away. His third touchdown put Florida State in front, 35-14. That was all the scoring in the third, but the Tribe wasn't through. Sean Jackson now in a tailback into the end zone. Getting out of hand here. 42-14. Seminole defense dominating. Detmer under pressure. Howard Dinkins, Dan Footman get to him for the safety. 44-14 FSU. BYU added two touchdowns. Made it.
I'm Jerome Jurenovich, CNN Headline Sports.
The pennant fever that has gripped the city of Atlanta has carried over from the stands to the field. The Braves used seven strong innings by John Smoltz and aggressive base running by Ron Gant, who scored all the way from first on a Dave Justice single, to shut out New York 2-0. That brought the tomahawk chop all the way out on the field and moved Atlanta 2-up on the Dodgers, who lost to Pittsburgh. Orlando Merced drove in a pair, and Jay Bell came up with the great defense in a 4-1 Pirates victory. The Bucs are currently 6 over second place St. Louis. That's because the Cardinal State lived up to its number one ranking by beating 19th-ranked BYU handedly. Casey Weldon tossed a pair of TD passes, and Edgar Bennett ran for a pair in the 44-28 final. And on a day when both top seeds
rose to Mexico.
Tom Snyder, CNN Headline Sports. A mark which some thought which football's top-ranked team didn't Mickey Mouse around in winning its season opener. Playing in the second annual Pigskin Classic, Florida State annihilated Heisman Trophy winner Ty Detmer and BYU 44-28. Seminoles quarterback Casey Weldon outgunned Detmer, throwing for 268 yards and a pair of touchdowns. Weldon was the game's MVP. From Tomahawks in Anaheim to Tomahawks in the home of the Braves. While Bobby Bowden's Knolls scalped the Cougars, the Atlanta Braves blanked the New York Mets to move two games in front of L.A. in the next.
Strong field of challengers prepare for the national championship battle. Can any of them deny early favorite Florida State? Or is this finally Bowden's year?
We're lipping out right now. One of these days those things are going to fall.
Miami has three titles, but the hurricane warning has been sounded. Can they still win as the Candy Canes?
We're singled out.
And we have singled out the games that will decide who's number one. There will be no hedging as College Game Day season premiere rolls your way.
The comfort of a conference soon, but this year, they again make up most of the top national title contenders, including current number one, Florida State.
The Seminoles return 17 starters, including the nation's best starting backfield. Junior QB Casey Weldon was 6-0 as a starter last season with just 4 interceptions. Anthony Ampley is one of the top 5 returning tailbacks, a junior that pro scouts already love. 2 Seminole concerns, an untested kicking game, and a schedule featuring road wars at Michigan and Florida. Plus, oh yes, Miami. The Canes are technically in the new Big East, but they've played just 2 conference games this year. Gone are 17 seniors, replacing them enough talent to maintain the excellence. No one has quicker, more athletic linebackers. And Gino Toretta, winner of the quarterback battle, is surrounded with weapons. He must develop quickly, though. The first 5 weeks include home dates with Houston and Penn State. The Nittany Lions have more big play weapons than ever before. 3 receivers with sub 4.5 times in the 40. Tony Sack is off to a great start with a school record 5 TD passes Wednesday against Georgia Tech. That will help patch up his sometimes rocky relationship with Paterno. No patchwork needed on the Lions' defense, though. They're punishing in deep. They return 8 starters. At Notre Dame, Lou Holtz must replace talented big names with talented no-names. The Rockets' early liftoff leaves a huge void. Tight end Derrick Brown should finally become a major part of the offense after just 47 catches in 3 years. The concerns are greater on defense. Chris Zorich, Todd Light, Mike Stonebreaker are all NFL rookies. Permanent suspension of tackle George Williams leaves the Irish with a front 7 that started just 4 games between them. The unknown defense will be tested almost every week as the Irish face 7 teams that went bowling last year. And speaking of punishing schedules, Louisville's includes Florida State, Tennessee, and Ohio State. Even without quarterback Browning Nagel, Howard Schnellenberger swears his 91 team will be as good as the one that ruined Bama's New Year at the Fiesta Bowl and won 10 games.
Mentioned Anaheim against Florida State. Cougars were pounded. Detmer spent a lot of time scrambling. One of his 2 touchdowns here also had an interception and a fumble. For the look at who's going to play tug of war with the trophy, here's Charlene Hawks. This year, it'll decide that payback time. Then FSU comes in.
It's Florida State Southern Speed against Northern Michigan Power.
Georgia Tech is Clemson's biggest test.
Tech dies in Death Valley.
Texas is OU's biggest test. They have Colorado at home, then Penn State at Miami.
I bet Miami doesn't wear the fatigues this time.
was Vols 45, Gators 3 last year. Payback in Gainesville in October. Then Washington visits the Coliseum.
This is Washington's national title game.
If Penn State can get to the Irish with one loss, that's going to be a big one. The Seminoles get the Canes at home this year, Lee.
The best athletes in the country are on the field November the 16th when Miami plays Florida State.
And this year, the Sooners and the Huskers, that game. National championship, but for annual bragging rights between those hostile neighbors. Game Day looks back at Bobby Bowden's last home game at West Virginia. Another wacky classic in the history of the backyard brawl.
Behind junior Tony Dorsett, the Panthers claw back to a 14-14 tie in the fourth quarter. Then, in the final minute, the Mountaineers are closing in for a game-winning field goal when Ron Lee coughs up the ball at the pit 19. But seconds later, on fourth and two from their 25, the Panthers also lose their poise.
He's lining up and going to go for it. And if he misses it, because we turn our kick field, so Johnny, he can't get his quarterback to stop, so Johnny just runs out on the field. Well, the officials have to stop him and throw a penalty on him. At least that stopped the clock. He said, to that quarterback, punt that football. But that was funny.
I don't remember much about that. Yeah, I think I tried to get the clock stopped.
Sorry, Johnny. It happened. And the unsportsmanlike conduct call backed Pitt's punter into the end zone. So, with 10 seconds remaining, West Virginia takes over with time for just one desperation play from the Panthers 48.
We hit Randy Swenson from Washington, D.C. We hit him a tight end. We hit him on the sideline, and knocked him out. And if it hadn't, we couldn't have got another pick. We didn't have time out there. It stopped the clock with 4 seconds to go, and Bill McKenzie came in and kicked the winning field goal.
It will be a 38-yard attempt. The snap. McKenzie kicks it. It is long enough. McKenzie kicks it. It is good. The ball game is over.
It is really one of my favorites. All-time victories, and I'm sure it was big in West Virginia thinking.
Father of 14, part good old boy, part Southern gentleman, part riverboat gambler. Bobby Bowden has built a personal empire in North Florida. After a quarter century in coaching, he's still pursuing college football's crown jewel with as much energy as ever.
You walked out on that field last night and just thought we were going to have a good time and I don't have to work hard.
Well, I've heard about that. There's all kinds of prizes, lots of fun, and all for all ages.
We got so many Auburn people here tonight, I might talk a little slower. But I got you too, then. Give it night-night, night-night. I'm glad we scrimmaged last night because I did not have the feeling last night we would have won. I did not have the feeling we would have won.
Motivating, teaching, and entertaining. Bobby Bowden knows how to balance them by being himself and by winning. Bowden has built a cult of personality unequaled in college football.
Wouldn't you like to spend 30 days just having people tell you how great you are and how much they love you, and asking you for autographs? And you know, he just eats it up. He might not last forever.
In the meantime, Bowden exploits his popularity. Lumber, sports drinks, hot dogs, and much more. Everybody wants old Coach Bowden as a spokesman or a guest speaker. Very few coaches can match his total income.
Bobby could sell ice to Eskimos. Or he could probably sell sunshine to Floridians.
Bowden's popularity stems partly from his bold play calling. But other coaches aren't always as fond of his sandlot principles brought to the big time.
Some of these coaches will say something about, well, that's juvenile stuff. That's high school stuff. And I always come back and say, yeah, but I only use it against high school mentalities.
Was it audacity or insanity to hope that your team would fall short on third down in order to try the now famous punt rooski with a critical game at stake? Or call the play now known as the dumb rooski, a backfired gamble which cost State a shot at last year's national title? Bowden knows both sides of the risk-taking principles that he learned by studying military history.
There are some generals that had audacity, and they happened to turn out to be great generals. There are some that were very conservative, and they were good generals, but they never turned out to be great generals. At least that's the way I see it. The great ones were very daring.
Snap, toss, sweep to Cedric Jones, going right. No, he's going to throw. He throws it back to Lowry.
Let's think of the trickiest thing we can think of and see if we can do it. Well, the kids get to having some fun with that, you know. and it'll help take their mind off of the drudgery of football.
There's never a point in time where I think you have to take this game so serious that it's going to, you know, cause you to have a nervous breakdown or something. And Coach Bowden, you know, balances that off perfectly with his humorous side.
Rival coaches snicker that St. Bobby, as some call him, is insulated from the pressure of the job as a media darling with a lifetime contract.
You know, it's about a foot's difference between a halo and a noose. You know, all you got to do is drop a halo down about a foot, you got your noose around your neck. So you're that close when they're calling you Saint.
Lifetime contract takes care of that, though, doesn't
They'll
it?
They'll burn that thing at the drop of a hat. You lose two games in a row, that lifetime contract, they'll burn it.
Now Bowden faces another season as a prime contender for the national championship that has eluded him. It is all he needs to join Joe Paterno as an active coaching legend.
The writers will all ask me, gosh, I bet you're just frustrated never winning a national championship. I'll be honest with you, I'm not frustrated one bit. I have never awakened in the middle of the night and said, oh, I've never won a national championship. It never bothered me a bit. Some people will misunderstand. They'll say, Bowden says he don't even care if they won a national championship. No, I didn't say that. I probably want one as bad as anybody in the world, but I'm not obsessed with it. I'm not going to cut my dadgum throat because we didn't win a national championship, you know, and I want one real bad.
Got over the first hurdle this year. Now, Bobby told me he wants to coach 10 more years if he stays in good health. That would mean through the year 2000 when he's 71. Lee, is 91 finally his year to win it all?
He's got a great chance, but he's got two major problems. Number one, his punt snapper is one of the worst punt snappers in America, and he better change him. And number two, he better put an ad in the Florida State newspaper to get another place kicker. Bobby Bowden and Florida State will lose one ball game because of one of those two situations. But I do think he'll beat Oklahoma in the Orange Bowl and win his first national championship.
Big test at Michigan. Now, one of Bobby's three sons in coaching, Tommy, replaced his favorite son, Pat Sullivan, as Auburn's offensive coordinator. A controversy there.
No replay. He took a major league blow. Rusty Spindell. Concentrate on the right center of your screen. Now he's left center of your screen. You'll see the umpire standing right there. He's trying to get out of the way. He gets hit in the back. Then he gets hit in the front. The ball pops up in the air. Boy, he actually was a stationary target there for two people.
You know, it's so ironic. Just a short time ago, I was down with Rusty down in the officials' locker room. He's out of the New Orleans area. A Cajun umpire, his mother, Enola Spindell, celebrating her 80th birthday last week. And he wanted to send along best wishes to his mother, proving that officials do have mothers. And now, Enola, the key thing you want is word that your son is okay. He took a major league hit. An umpire, the toughest thing about that spot on the field is just what you saw. The action comes right at you from every spot. Right there, the umpire. See how he's right there in the pit area?
See, and he's moving forward mechanically just like he's supposed to, but the defender coming from the back, you'll see him come in, and he'll push him into another defender coming from the front. Boom. Boom, there he gets smashed right there. And remember, they're not wearing helmets.
But a nice smile. And so Enola, happy birthday. Son Rusty is feeling much better right now. And happy birthday back there in New Orleans. I'll bet you he's back.
And Vic Brinzey.
Well, Bert, 1990 starts out as a promising season. Bobby Bowden is looking forward to his 200th victory.
Yeah, but he's got three unbelievable first games, right? Auburn, Miami, and then LSU.
And LSU, and unfortunately, Florida State falls to Miami. They fall to Auburn, and up comes LSU. And Bobby Bowden has his hands full because now he's got to turn the career around, or the season around.
Yeah, not only is, yeah, you're absolutely right about the season. And I remember I was watching that game with Bobby Bowden's favorite movie actress, Anne Margaret, who was going totally crazy. And the game just sort of seemed, just the momentum of the game just shifted real fast on about the very first second play.
On the opening kickoff, there's a fumble. Florida State recovers it, and Ampley takes it in for 9 yards, from 9 yards
Ampley
out.
Ampley had, I think, his best game, right?
He scored three touchdowns that ball game, but the second series, Florida State finds another wide receiver, Matt Fryer.
Yeah, this kid is amazing. And not only do you find him, but you find him over the middle, where all the headhunters are. And he's not that big. He's not that fast. That's what they said about Blitnikoff, right?
Absolutely. And Casey Weldon finds him. But, you know, before every half, what you look for is you want to score a touchdown. Well, Florida State comes out with a Hail Mary pass to finish up the second half.
and they find Weldon downfield looking at Shannon Baker.
Well, if I'm going to throw a Hail Mary, I'm going to throw Shannon Baker.
Well, Florida State gets on the winning track again.
You're not whooping. And if we come out at the end of the season, I think fourth.
Fourth in the nation?
Fourth in the nation.
Bobby Bowden gets his 200th win, beats LSU 42-3, and Florida State just looks back and over its shoulder for the rest of the season.
That's right. LSU, welcome to Tallahassee.
Join us next week for another great moment in Florida State football with Burt Reynolds and Vic Frenzy.
Five games.
You may have missed the latest Associated Press Top 20 poll. If you did, Seminoles, what a surprise, remain number one with 54 first-place votes. Michigan with only one first-place tally, along with Miami. The Hurricanes, of course, beat Arkansas over the weekend. Washington remains number four with Penn State moving up to number seven after knocking off Georgia Tech. The Gators got bumped from 5 to 6. Notre Dame fell a spot with Clemson, Oklahoma, and Houston rounding out the top 10. Georgia Tech dropping from 8 to 17 after that loss to the Nittany Lions. Does the future look bright at FSU? Consider the debut of freshman defensive back Derek Brooks. Number 10 saw action in only 11 plays against BYU, and he made an impact in nearly every one. The USA Today Defensive Player of the Year was slow to learn the FSU system, but he's found out the best way to play is on instinct.
It kind of felt good, you know, being out there, and I wasn't thinking about making mistakes like I used to doing practice. I just let loose and played, and, you know, the hits came from, you know, they just came. Give me a lot of confidence, you know. I kind of got, you know, adjusted to the college speed, and it's not that much difference. You know, I feel like I can come in and do a lot my first
year. Cougar country.
Drop down there. On third and long, Weldon throws a strike.
The 1-2 punch of Ampley and Edgar Bennett is too much for the defending WAC champions.
Oh, well, Donnie Johnson, handoff to Bennett. Bennett sidesteps, spins, touchdown, Florida State. Second effort by Edgar Bennett. He scored his second touchdown of the game. It's 13-0 FSU.
In order to run up the middle like they
play, makes like a thief in the night.
Myers looks long. It is nearly. It's picked off by Terrell Buckley. Buckley goes airborne between two defenders.
The Seminoles waste a big Ampley run.
Inside the 35 to the 30 to the 25. Penalty flag thrown. He is to the 15-yard line and run out of bounds at the 13-yard line. Will be holding on FSU.
That's something you just got to correct. You can't win the close games with those big penalties. And
avoid a quick trip to Blowout City. BYU has to get it going.
Now turns around on his own end zone. It is caught by Tui Pelotu. He has the first down out across the 23-yard line.
A questionable call keeps the drive alive.
Dead ball. Personal foul.
Of BYU. The lay handoff. Guerrier misses a tackle with the football. Tua Pelotu bangs and pounds his way to the 46-yard line. Boy, he took a vicious hit by 2-3 Seminoles.
The gut of the Tribe D, and it looks like a new ball game.
This is Bennett, whips to the outside, makes a cut to the 30, to the 35. Bennett is hit and dropped, but he's got a first down and then some.
The Noles continue to rip apart the Cougar defense. Casey Weldon hits junior flanker Eric Terrell for key first down yardage.
Throws to the near side, it is caught. Eric Terrell, the junior from Tallahassee, Godfrey High School, on the reception. It's good.
From the Cougar 49, the veteran FSU backfield takes over.
Now to Lee, makes the catch to the 40. Lee to the sideline to the 30. Lee cuts it inside to the 20-yard line. One-handed catch by Lee, and he really puts on the afterburner and scoots all the way to the 20.
Second and goal from the 6. The rejuvenated E.T. starts off 91, posting career numbers. 6 receptions, a game-high 96 yards. A star is on the rise. Casey finds Matt Pryor for 2, and FSU is on top, 21-7. After the deep Maori kick, BYU starts, then finishes on its own 20. He's back. to hunt heads for another season. Casey Weldon shows he may have some Heisman dreams of his own. Edgar Bennett somehow survived to make the huge third down play.
That was just something more of willpower. I really wanted to show the guy that, you know, he got a good shot on me, but he didn't knock the ball free. And I just wanted to make sure I came down with the ball.
Screen pass to his flanker. This is Terrell. Terrell to the 25, to the 20. Terrell to the 15-yard line. He's got a first down. That play has worked so many times in practice. Didn't know if we'd see it tonight.
Bennett pounds the middle for nine.
This is Bennett. Makes his cut inside the 10. Bennett inside the 5 to the 4-yard line.
Amp Lee zips around the right side. FSU looks unstoppable. BYU shows some quick firepower of its own. Tui Folau again finds the middle to his liking as the Cougars get six on the ground. Just before half, Terrell Buckley uses clips of plenty to electrify the plays. The first half ends with two. The Cougars would total a measly 33 yards rushing on the night.
Our first goal of victory.
With the veteran offensive line controlling the line of scrimmage, the Tribe powers downfield.
Weldon rolls to his left, still rolling, throws it downfield, has a receiver. It is caught by Terrell, and Terrell is bulldogged out of bounds at the 41-yard line. First down from the 40, Weldon hands off to Lee. Lee circles to the left and is run out of bounds as he got it to the 45-yard line.
No, I wasn't surprised by that.
Receivers answer the call. Redshirt freshman Kez McCorvey latches on to his first reception wearing the garnet and gold. Amp Lee blasts off around left end, 20 quick yards, but the twisted tackle grounds the Chipley tailback for the rest of the night.
My leg was hurting when it first happened, because I didn't know what it was. But I was worried, definitely. They just told me to ice it out, and, you know, I'm not sure, you know, how long that's going to be. But, personally, I feel that with time, I'll be all right.
Game goes on. Third and three from the BYU 4. Weldon goes to his right. He's going to keep it. Head down into a Cougar stampede.
I'll be going out of bounds from now on.
Good idea, Casey. On fourth down, Edgar Bennett barges through the middle for his third touchdown of the game. The finishing touch of the 11-play mega drive. Detmer has to go to the air.
Real play fake and roll to his right. Under pressure by Troy Sanders. Sanders will collar him and bring him down. The kid from Alba, Alabama was blocked again, and just refused to take the block and fought off it and dropped him for a 7-yard loss.
Well, was in a jet
snap. And plenty of protection gets the kick away, and this is a boomer. Backpedaling is Buckley up the 17-yard line. Slips, keeps his balance, tries to go to his right. He stays on his feet, breaks a tackle. He breaks another tackle, and he's going to be hit, collared, and spun backwards at the 11.
The Tribe offense digs out of the hole.
Kickoff goes two-minute. No, a play fake by Walden, executed nicely, gets the pass away, caught by Sean Jackson. 25 to the 30-yard line goes Jackson. 34, play fake by Walden, pirouettes, drops back, throws downfield, has a receiver wide open, McCorvey makes the catch at the 45, he has a Florida State first down. Right, quick snap to Walden, he'll drop the throw, dumps it across the middle, caught by Bennett, Bennett to the 50, to the 49-yard line.
Third and five for midfield, the sure-handed Bennett makes the spectacular grab, but Casey was over the line. After the Seminole defense again stymies BYU, Casey Weldon mixes the run and pass as the FSU offensive onslaught continues.
From the 44, Weldon play fakes, throws far side of the field, caught ball at the BYU 45-yard line.
In 1991, Florida State is 2-3 deep at virtually every position. Sophomore Sean Jackson showcases his talents.
Toss sweep to Jackson, right side. Jackson puts his head down. He has a Florida State touchdown.
On the ensuing kickoff, a BYU clip has the Cougars pinned back deep, just where Man Mountain Dan Footman wants them.
A minimum of two, at least I got two.
The Seminoles give up a couple of late scores, but this one is over early. Florida State uses 543 total yards of offensive might to whip BYU 44-28. Casey Weldon's 1991 debut is magnificent. The Tallahassee native completes 21 of 28 passes for 268 yards and a pair of TDs. The first time in school history, Florida State University is ranked number one during the regular season. Showed the Cougars and the nation he'll be a force to be reckoned with in the powerhouse Tribe backfield. Bennett tore through BYU for a career-high 101 yards rushing, including two TDs. And number 22 was a favorite target of Casey Weldon, snaring six receptions for 65 yards and another score.
I really feel that was probably my best game ever at Florida State, you know, but again, I have to give credit to the offensive line for giving me room to run. Those guys just did a great job, and I just, you know, picked holes.
Glad you stayed around, Edgar Bennett, our Seminole Uprising Player of the Week. Next week, the Tribe returns home to entertain the Green Wave of Tulane. Doe Campbell will be rocking. Join us next week for all the highlights and interviews right here on Seminole Uprising.
Performance, you know, not so much that I had a bad game, but I really didn't get a chance to do a whole lot. I mean, I expect to make more big plays.
This is Brown. This week's game against Tulane will really be his first test at playing a true strong safety role and give Davis a chance to do what he does best.
To be honest, I think I might like it, this the strong safety position a little more than I like the free safety, due to the fact that I'm able to make more big plays and and be seen more, you know, as far as from an aggressive standpoint.
In his career, Davis has intercepted four passes, all from the free safety position. But this week, he's looking to mix it up with Tulane's leading ball carrier, Chance Miller, who ripped the Seminoles last year for 97 yards.
You think their offense will present more big play opportunities for yourself?
No doubt. I think they will, because Tulane have a tendency of running the ball a lot more than what BYU did.
Off on Saturday night, the Seminoles will be doing the same at Doe Campbell Stadium. Here are some notes on the home opener. It'll be the first time FSU has carried the banner of number one in the nation into a home game. Of course, they have won 11 straight in the friendly confines, looking to make it an even dozen. The odds makers say it will happen with a point spread of 41. My, is there the possibility of overconfidence in this one?
I see the fans looking at that, but I just want to say there's no need to worry, because Coach won't let it happen.
Okay.